So the reason why the so-called hidden costs of climate change are so important are in part because they're often subtle and hard to notice, but the data increasingly suggests that they're quite pervasive. So whether that's things like how temperature affects worker productivity or safety and health on the job, or even something like cognitive performance at work or in school, there's increasingly evidence to suggest that even a so-called non-catastrophic warming scenario, even a little bit of warming, can adversely affect the economic machinery of our day-to-day lives in important ways.
Welcome to The Ripple Effect, the podcast that takes you on a journey through the minds of Wharton faculty. I'm your host, Dan Loney, and in each episode, we'll be diving deep into the inspiration behind the groundbreaking research that Wharton professors have conducted and exploring how their findings resonate with the world today.
Well, the focus on climate change has many people looking at the impacts of global warming, and in many instances, the costs can be somewhat hidden, but can be very important nonetheless. Many of these are everyday implications. Pleasure to be joined right now by Dr. Jisung Park, who's an associate professor in the School of Social Policy and Practice here at the University of Pennsylvania. Jisung is also author of the book Slow Burn: The Hidden Costs of a Warming World. Jisung, great to have you with us today.
Dan, it's great to be here, and I hope to be associate one day. I'm still an assistant professor, but thank you for that vote of confidence.
My apologies. I apologize for that. And I guess it is that component of everyday costs that you focus on in the book that is very important to this overall kind of viewing of where we are thinking about global warming.
That's right, Dan. And if I could just take a quick step back, you know, a primary motivation behind a lot of my research and certainly the book has been to help decision makers and the public at large develop a better familiarity with these, what you're calling everyday costs of climate change. And I think to understand why that's important, it helps to take a step back to think about the historical context, right? Historically, I think many of our viewers, your viewers, are used to thinking about climate change, if they were thinking about climate change at all, as sort of a planetary catastrophe insurance, right? Like you've heard terms such as uninhabitable Earth, extinction rebellion, right? It's not uncommon for us to think about climate change in terms of the broader framing as sort of we succeed and we prevent, you know, planetary collapse, or we don't and we're just completely doomed. And I think, you know, it's important increasingly as more and more of the public and more business leaders and decision makers grapple with this issue as, you know, not just a tangential issue, but potentially a core issue to our decision making, to really become more familiar with, okay, what does the data say about the so-called non-catastrophic consequences of climate change? And that isn't because, you know, the framing of acting on climate change as a form of catastrophe insurance is incorrect. I think there's a lot of evidence to suggest that to a first order, that's probably the right framework to use. But just from a practical perspective, as we think about how to sustain our, you know, engagement with and political will to move forward in terms of decarbonization, which, you know, it's much more of a dial than a switch than I think most people tend to talk about it or think about it as. And as we think about, you know, adaptation, right? What kinds of practical decisions need to be made, whether you're a mayor or a principal or a business leader, to help adapt your organization's operations to the effects of climate change that are already happening. I think that's sort of the motivation behind really trying to focus on the data-driven implications of the everyday costs.
So give us an example of this, because from what you just said, you were saying a mayor or a principal, and those are obviously two important jobs, but in many cases, they're very different jobs. And
true.
So it feels like there's a kind of a wide range of areas we can look at when you're talking about the impact of these costs associated with climate change.
Absolutely, Dan. And I have to say, you know, as for someone who has been working in this area for several years, actually over a decade now, I continue to be amazed at what the data tells us are the scope of ways in which climate change may already be affecting us. So I'm thinking about research that finds, let's start at the top. So it's, you know, we now know that depending on the country you live in, depending on the industry, extreme temperature and extreme rainfall can have very significant consequences for manufacturing productivity, construction productivity. We also know that it can affect health in a variety of ways. Mortality responses to extreme heat are among the biggest drivers of climate-related health disruptions. But it's not just death, you know, it's other dimensions of suffering. Hospitalizations go up when the temperature is hotter. We know from some of my own research with co-authors that workers in certain occupations and industries, their propensity to be hurt on the job goes up on hotter days. Student learning is incidentally also affected, albeit in highly varied and in many cases very subtle ways, by the temperature environment in which learning happens. I mean, learning is kind of hard enough as it is, but if you add to the mix, you know, especially in settings where you don't have, you know, complete cooling infrastructure or where extreme heat is very frequent, you know, we find that there is a subtle but measurable effect on both cognitive performance in the short run and the accumulation of human capital, right, which, as we know, is so important to economic flourishing, both individually and sort of in a macro sense, in the long run. So, heat can affect learning. There are also ways in which, you know, the climate in which we live, whether it's, you know, temperature changes or air pollution from wildfire smoke, can affect your mood, you know, can actually affect how much profanity you see on your Twitter feed, you know. So there are all these many sort of subtle ways in which a changing climate changes our quality of life. That's why I say, you know, a mayor or principal or leader of a Fortune 500 company, they're all ways in which your operations might be affected. I can't tell you which ways they are, but I can tell you that there's a large menu of studies that document clear links between changes in weather patterns, changes in climate variables, and these kinds of economically relevant outcomes.
So then I would also throw out the idea that there are probably events that occur out there in our society that end up having a downstream impact on climate. And I'll just throw one out. Recently, we saw in Baltimore, the Francis Scott Key Bridge, the boat hits the base of the structure, knocks the bridge down. And obviously it has forced a large level of change in that part of the United States in terms of traffic, you know, use, the level of, I mean, there are some impacts from climate because you don't have this bridge available now for the next several years.
You mean in terms of the knock-on effects on emissions?
Correct. Correct.
Absolutely. I mean, transportation is obviously a very large source of our emissions, and anything that can affect transportation patterns in the shorter or long run, that'll have effects on emissions. Where I thought you were going with that, Dan, is also that there are hidden effects from climatological disasters that can affect things like bridges on not only the infrastructure, but also on, you know, less visible aspects of the economy.
Well, and that too, because I think there's a larger discussion going on right now about infrastructure and making sure that we have, you know, structurally sound bridges, roads, et cetera, as well.
100%. Right. And I'm not an engineer, but my cursory read of the engineering reports is that America's infrastructure has many, let's say, the grades aren't, you know, great, but that's in a stable climate. If you add, you know, a changing climate to the mix, you know, chances are that the need, the urgency of revamping the infrastructure may be greater, especially given what we know about, you know, how climate change will affect things like the propensity of extreme rainfall and flooding, for instance.
Well, and the other thing is we talk about these issues a lot in the scope of here in the United States, but this is a larger conversation as well, where these types of events and impacts are occurring all around the world, maybe with different level of impact, but they're still happening.
100%, right? And I have to say, you know, the U.S. has obviously been a focus of much of our attention because that's where we live. And in some cases, from a researcher standpoint, we're guilty of, you know, looking for our keys under the lamppost in the sense that in many cases, to the extent that sometimes your research is guided by data availability, You know, places like the U.S. have better data than many other developing countries, but that shouldn't take away from the very obvious point that, you know, these effects from climate change that are documented are, of course, not only happening in developed economies like the U.S., but if anything, one might expect the magnitude of the effects to be larger, depending on the hazard, of course. But in developing countries, just to give you sort of heuristic that I like to think about is, you know, for a given level of warming, how many more potentially damagingly hot days are we talking about from climate change? And, you know, there are parts of the U.S. where over the next 2 to 3 decades, we're expected to see, say, you know, a dozen or two dozen more days every summer above 90 degrees Fahrenheit, just to pick a threshold. That number in a place like Thailand or Brazil can be over 100 additional days per year above 90 degrees Fahrenheit. And that's already on a very warm base, so to speak. And so, yeah, absolutely, there is a sense in which we can lose sight of the international dimension of climate damages and also the potential inequality in damages across countries, given the, you know, differences in both the amount of warming and the underlying sort of infrastructure and economic composition.
So you just used the word inequality, and that is obviously another area that's very important. It's very much a talking point here in the U.S. on a variety of different fronts.
Sure.
How much do you see these impacts having an impact on the level of inequality that we see here in the United States and other cultures around the globe?
Yeah, that's a great question, Dan. I mean, there are many ways one can think about inequality. I tend to like to frame it as, you know, what are the differences in individuals' ability to achieve a flourishing, flourishing life? And there are many inputs to that, but you can imagine that, you know, some probably necessary inputs may include things like health, you know, the ability to secure a financial livelihood, safety of your environment. And to the extent that, you know, research now increasingly indicates that all of those three dimensions that I just mentioned, again, which are not exhaustive, are adversely affected by climate hazards, and to the extent that we know both internationally and interpersonally within countries, be that developed or developing, we've seen increasing, you know, wage inequality, income inequality, and in many cases, health inequality. That's the backdrop upon which these impacts of climate change are occurring. And so one can imagine that if things keep going the way they're going in the sort of social and policy systems that we have been living through, you can imagine that climate change has a likelihood of increasing those inequalities, whether that's in, you know, livelihoods or health or what have you.
What do you think then needs to be looked at now to improve things? And I guess one of the things you've also talked about is even maybe a path towards more aggressive cutting, looking when you're talking about emissions.
Yeah, let me get to the emissions cutting in a second. I would like to actually say first that one of the things that can and should be done is a shift in the narrative. I really do believe, Dan, that the way we as individuals and as a broader public think about and talk about climate change and acting on climate change, climate policy is really important. And getting back to the earlier point at the outset about, you know, framing climate change as less of a binary black, white, on, off, and more of a sort of sliding scale, I think that will be important as we move forward in making collective and individual decisions about what we should do about it, how much we should be investing to do something about it. Just to give us a concrete example, again, you know, I think there's a great deal of support now for the inevitability of the transition away from fossil fuels, right? You hear about the clean energy transition, the green transition, et cetera. But if you look under the hood, there's less consensus about how quickly, at what cost, right? Privileging which industries over others. And so those conversations take as essential factual inputs, among other things, the damages from a warmer planet, and not just the binary of, hey, you know, 5 degrees of warming and we're all doomed versus, you know, pre-industrial. It's every part, every degree on that spectrum represents either damages we avoid, so benefits from acting, or costs of acting and reducing those emissions. So the more I think as a public we can understand that climate change, as with many policy issues, has a bunch of gray area that we need to operate in, and that increasingly there is the data to support a more quantitatively nuanced understanding of the gray area, I think we can have, I think that would allow us to have a more constructive and sustained debate about how much we should be reducing emissions, how aggressively, how quickly, et cetera. Just one data point I will note, and I mentioned in the book, in terms of the ideal stringency or aggressivity of emissions cuts. So your listeners may be familiar with the concept called the social cost of carbon. If they are not, the basic idea, right, is it represents the discounted present value of the total damages to society that are set in motion by us emitting an additional ton of CO2 today. That number, of course, there's a lot that goes into that number, both theoretical and empirical, but that number in some sense represents, right, the severity of the climate change problem. That number, at least according to recent EPA updates that incorporate a lot of the studies that I have mentioned, although not all of them, is somewhere in the ballpark of $190 per ton CO2. You know, less than a decade ago, that number was somewhere in the ballpark of $50 per ton, 50 CO2. Right. And so just to give you a sense of how potentially serious the costs of climate change are, another way to think about that is, with some assumptions, right, it's as if we're putting in motion every year globally, given the amount of emissions we emit on an average basis as a world, we're setting in motion many trillions, several trillions of dollars worth of, right, discounted future damages because of our emissions. So that should give us at least some sense of how much we should as a society be willing to pay to cut those emissions if you believe in benefit cost analysis, which I do, at least as one input to decision making. So that's a long-winded way of saying, you know, I think we can start with changing the narrative a little bit on how we think about climate action. The other point briefly that I'll mention is that, right, almost irrespective of how quickly we're able to reduce emissions, there's going to be a lot of adaptation that needs to happen between now and a stable climate, whenever that ends up being. And I think that the more we can familiarize ourselves with the everyday costs, the everyday impacts of a changing climate, even in a so-called non-catastrophic scenario, I think the more nuanced our interventions can be in helping our organizations, our societies adapt to the climate change that's coming. Sorry for the long response.
No, but it's great because you covered all the bases on this. Jisung, great to have you with us today. Thanks very much for your time.
Thank you, Dan. It was a pleasure.
You got it. Dr. Jisung Park, assistant professor in the School of Social Policy and Practice. Hopefully not for long. At the University of Pennsylvania. The book is titled Slow Burn, The Hidden Costs of a Warming World. It's available in bookstores and online right now. Thank you for listening to The Ripple Effect. We hope you found this episode informative and engaging. Don't forget to subscribe and leave us a review so that we can continue to bring you the best insight from the Wharton School.